section that's left in chapter 6, which is the measures of inequality. Besides a figurative or a graphical vision of inequality, it is always and always, especially for economists, it is always important to have a number, to have a quantitative idea of what exactly is the extent of inequality, and that has to be represented by a number. And that is what we are going to discuss in this section, where we are going to talk about different possible measures of inequality and which one of these measures satisfy what principle, which principle, and what is the most relevant measure of inequality that we use when we try and compare communities or countries or regions. All right. Before we start discussing these measures, it is important to first look at these notations here. Now, suppose that there are m distinct incomes, and these are basically not one particular level of income, these are income classes. And in each income class, so we're just placing these notations so that the measures are clearer. We are saying that in a population, there are m distinct income classes. In each of these income classes J, the number of individuals earning the income is denoted by Nj. So number of people in that particular income class is denoted by Nj. And hence, the total number of people in the population will be summation Nj when J ranges from 1 to m. So total income classes are M, and we are saying that each income class is represented by J, and number of people in each income class is J. So total number of people in the entire population will be sum of this NJ when J ranges from 1 to M, right? So that represents the total number of people in the community. And hence, to calculate the average income of the entire population, what we have here is, so this represents the average income for the entire population. This summation represents the total income of the population. So Nj multiplied by Yj, meaning income class J, the level of income in class J multiplied by the number of people in class J, and we are summing this from 1 to m, which basically takes into consideration every income class in the population. And hence, this summation term will give you the total level of income in the population. You divide it by n, that is the total number of people, and that will give you the average income of the population. So we have to keep this in mind. In the following measures, we are just going to use this term mu. But what exactly is mu is given by this term here. All right. Now, moving ahead with the exact measures of inequality. So we are going to discuss five measures of inequality in total. And the first one is the most primary measure of inequality, that is the range. Now, I'm sure you all would know what range is. So range basically is the difference in the incomes of the richest and the poorest individual in a population, and you divide it by mean to express it independent of the units in which income is measured. So obviously income could be measured in different units across different countries, across different regions. So to standardize that, we are dividing the difference in the incomes of the richest and the poorest individual by the average income, so that we get a standardized measure. So range is a very simple measure. You take the income of the richest individual, which is YM. You take the income of the poorest individual, which is Y1, and you take a difference of the two. But obviously, I mean, it is a very, very crude measure, a very basic measure, and it hides a lot of information. And definitely this one is not used. Just to get a very basic idea of the population, obviously you can use this measure, but definitely you don't use this measure that often, because it sort of hides a lot of lot of information, as well as it doesn't satisfy a lot of important principles that we have discussed in the previous classes. obviously it fails to satisfy the most important principle, which is the Dalton principle, because if you make any kind of transfer, any kind of regressive transfer in this population, by transferring, say, income from the poorest, from one of the poor individuals to the rich, to a less poor individual, then the measure would not change, because you are only taking into consideration the first income class and the second and the last income class. Anything that happens in between, so say there are some kinds of regressive transfers being made, then this doesn't matter at all for the measure. The measure would stay unchanged when this is happening. So definitely it doesn't satisfy the Dalton principle. Yeah, so I mean, it's quite clear that we don't use this measure for understanding inequality. The next measure is the Kuznets ratio. Now, this ratio, as the name indicates, is being introduced by Simon Kuznets, and in his study of income distributions in developed and developing countries, he had used these ratios. Now, these ratios basically refer to the share of income owned by poorest X percent to the by the richest Y percent. So you basically, you can have multiple variations of these ratios. So for example, you take the share of income owned by the poorest 20% or say 40% of the population, or by richest 10%, or more commonly to the ratio share. Yeah, I mean, basically you take income shares of X percentage of the population to the income share of Y percentage of the population. Right. So and these X and Y could vary depending on your need. This could be 20, this could be 40, anything. I mean, depending on what exactly you want to understand from the distribution. But again, since this is also taking into consideration a particular share of the distribution, again, it hides a lot of information and it suffers from the same kinds of issues that the first measure suffered from, which is the range. So again, I mean, this is not a very detailed measure of inequality, and we don't really use this measure as well when we try and understand inequality in different zones. Now, the third measure of inequality is the mean absolute deviation. And this is our first measure in our discussion that takes into account the entire income distribution. Now, the idea of this measure is simple. It says that inequality is proportional to the distance from the mean income. To understand inequality, you basically, I mean, what exactly is the basic intention? Is that how far are the data points from its average value? So suppose you have a distribution, and it could be any distribution. I mean, right now we're talking about income distribution, but for it holds true for any general distribution as well, that if you want to understand the level of variance or the level of inequality in the distribution, what do you want to know? You want to know that how far is each data point from its mean value. And that is the idea of mean absolute deviation. So what do we really do here is that we take the difference between the income of each income class from its mean value, from the mean value of the entire distribution. Remember, this mu is something that we had just looked at when we started discussing these measures of inequality. So this mu represents the income of the entire distribution, and what you're doing here is that for each income class J, you take the difference of the total income and the mean income. So NJ into YJ will give you the total income for an income class J, and mu gives you the mean income, and you sum this difference for all the income classes in the population. So they have actually missed out on the deviation sign, the absolute sign, but this is, since this is mean absolute deviation, we also take the absolute values here, meaning that obviously it is possible that this NJYJ at times will be less than the mean income, but we are not taking into consideration negative values, because you know that if you take into consideration the negative values, then the sum will become zero. So we take the positive values only into account, and we take the absolute of this difference. And then you divide it by the mean income to standardize for the measure. So suppose income is measured in dollars, or for any other community, the income is measured in rupees. So to sort of cancel that effect out, you divide it by mu, which is the average income, and also by n. N represents the total number of people. So because this is a mean absolute deviation, you have to also take an average value here, right? So you divide it by mu, product of mu and n. This measure looks as a better measure than the rest, than the previous two measures, which is the Kuznets ratio and the range. But again, this measure is also insensitive to the Dalton principle, meaning it doesn't satisfy the Dalton principle. Now let's look at how it doesn't satisfy the Dalton principle. So suppose that there are two people with income levels yj and yk, such that yj is below the mean of the population and yk is above the mean income of the population. Then a regressive transfer from yj to yk certainly raises inequality as measured by m. This is obvious from the formula because the distance of both yj and yk goes up and no other distance is altered. So m unambiguously will rise. I think it's better if we understand this using an example. Alright, so the basic idea of the paragraph here is that they are saying that this measure has to satisfy Dalton principle. What we really need is that if there are two income levels where yj is less than yk, then any transfer made from yj to yk, which is a regressive transfer, any transfer made from yj to yk should increase the value of m. Because m is a measure of inequality, so we say that if there is a regressive transfer, then inequality should increase. This should hold true for Dalton principle to satisfy. Now, what we are saying here is that suppose you have an income, the mean income, let's fix this value to say 20, right? And we are saying that suppose yj is 15. So yj is 15, which is less than the mean income, right? And yk is say 25, which is more than the mean income. Now the author says that if there is any transfer from yj to yk, where yj is less than yk, and also yj is below the mean income and yk is above the mean income. If this is the kind of situation, and if in this situation any regressive transfer is occurring, then the value of m will definitely increase. Why would it increase? Because m is nothing but the deviation of the income points from the mean value. And you will notice that if there is any transfer, say this person transfers unit 1 to yk, so this will become 14, right, and this will become 26. And you will notice that in these two situations, in case 1 and in case 2, if you take the deviations of yj from mu and yk from mu, both of them are increasing. Since we are taking absolute deviations, meaning positive values, you will notice that both of them are contributing positively. So initially yj was 5 less than the mean income, now yj is 6 less than the mean income. The mean will still stay the same because the overall sum doesn't get changed. You are just transferring a unit of your income to another person in the distribution. And also note that no other income level is getting disturbed, so you are not really changing any other income level in the distribution. Similarly, for yk, you will notice that in case 1, it was 5 plus the mean income, and now it is 6 plus the mean income. So, in absolute sense, in case 2, the deviations of yj and yk from the mean value is increasing. So, it satisfies the Dalton principle. But in the situation where, say, the regressive transfer is occurring on one side of the mean value. We are still keeping the mean value to be 20, but now I am keeping both yj and yk on the right hand side of the mean value. Now say this is 25, yj is 25 and yk is 28, right? Now again, this person is poorer than this person. So a regressive transfer from yj to yk, according to the Dalton principle, should still increase the inequality. But for this measure, in such situations where you are making the regressive transfer on one side of the mean value, this will not hold true. And we'll see how. So now you notice, suppose yj transfers again a unit of its income to yk. And so yj will now have 24 and yk will have 29. Now look at the distance of difference in the distance of yj from mean income. Yj was 5 plus the mean income initially, and now it is plus 4. Right? So, and this one was plus 8 and now this is plus 9. So, basically you will notice that there will be no difference in the value of M, or there will be no difference in the distance of the mean, distance of these data points from the mean value. So, if the total distance of yj and yk from mu in the first case was plus 5 and plus 8, which was 13, it still stays the same in the second case as well, plus 4 and plus 9, right? So the difference from the mean income stays the same even after the regressive transfer has been made. So M will not change, but to satisfy the Dalton principle, M should have increased. So again, we can say from this example, we can say that the mean absolute deviation as a measure of inequality doesn't satisfy the Dalton principle, because the Dalton principle, if it is satisfied, it has to hold true for all kinds of regressive transfers, not just the regressive transfer from an income level below the mean income to an income level above the mean income. It should hold true for any kind of regressive transfer. Okay? We conclude and we say that this measure, although it takes into account the entire distribution, we still cannot use this measure because this measure doesn't satisfy the Dalton principle. So moving ahead to the next measure, which is the coefficient of variation. Now one way to avoid this insensitivity of the previous measure to the Dalton principle is by giving more weight to larger deviations from the mean. So we should ideally have weighted deviations instead of just taking absolute deviations, mean absolute deviations. We should give larger weights to distances which are farther from the mean income, and similarly smaller weights to income points which are closer to the mean income, right? So say this is mean income and you have yj and yk, then more weight should be given to this value and less weight should be given to this value, because this is closer. So we should have, one way to avoid the problem of violation of Dalton principle is to give weights to the weights to the income level in the population. So how can we do that is by taking a standard deviation of the population, which basically squares all the deviations from the mean. So now instead of taking absolute deviation, what we are doing is that we are squaring the deviations. And because we know that when we take the square of a number, if it is smaller, it becomes even smaller. If it is larger, then it becomes even larger. So that is the property that this functional form has intrinsically, that if you take the square of anything, it will automatically give weights to the deviations. So this is the fourth measure of inequality. And I'm sure we all are aware of this measure because you would have done this in statistics or econometrics a lot of times. So what is happening here? Now you are taking the square of the deviation. So yj minus mu, you square this and then you multiply this with nj, which represents the total number of people in class, in income class j, and summing this from 1 to m. And you take the square root of this, because this you're not taking the variance, you're taking the standard deviation, and simply divided by the total income, mu into n. Now you will notice that this particular measure actually satisfies all the four principles, and it is also Lorentz consistent. Now basically this will also satisfy the Dalton principle, and it will hold true for any kind of transfers. Now, so you transfer income from income level J to K, where YJ is less than equal to YK, you will notice that the measure of inequality, that is coefficient of variation, will unambiguously increase. We can actually look at the same example, but now we'll try and square the differences. So say you have 20 as the mean income, 25, let's say that is YJ, and 28 is YK. Now and we said that it will change to, if we make a regressive transfer, then 25 will transfer a unit of its income to 28. So 25 will become 24 and 28 will become 29, right? Initially, in the previous case, we saw that the total deviation will stay the same. Plus 4, plus 9, plus 13. In this case as well, plus 5 and plus 8 will be plus 13. So in case of the previous measure, no change in the inequality. But let's look at coefficient of variation. So what is the difference here? The difference for YJ is 5, and if we square this, it will become 25, right? So this is the square of the deviation. I'm just denoting deviation by D, and we are squaring the deviations. So for the first case, it will be 25. For the second case, it is plus 8, and I am squaring this, it will become 64, right? When we make the regressive transfer, this is case 1, when original distribution, and this is case 2, when you have made the regressive transfer. Now, the deviation square in this case will be plus 4. If I square this, it will become 16, and plus 9 will become 81. Squaring plus 9, 81. Now, notice that the total, again, we will sum both these deviations, 16 plus 81 and 25 plus 64. Would you now notice a change in the value of C? You will notice that the sum of the squared deviations in case 2 is 97, and the sum of squared deviations in case 1, original distribution, is 89. And we see that this is greater than 89. So definitely the value of C will increase. So, and you can also check the same for transfers below the mean income to above the mean income. You will notice that by taking the square of the deviations, you give more weight to larger deviations. So the increase in plus 9, I mean the larger change, is given more weight. You will notice that the increase in this value, from this value, is much greater than the decrease in this value, right? And that is what we really mean by giving weights to different distances from the mean income. We are giving larger weight to distant deviations as compared to the closer deviation. So coefficient of variation satisfies all properties, and hence could be is a possible candidate for a good measure of inequality. The next and the last measure of inequality that we have to discuss is the Gini's coefficient. Now, this approach is actually fundamentally very different from the measures that we have discussed so far, which is M and C. Now, instead, the basic principle is different, right? Because when we were talking about mean absolute deviation, we had set the basic principle that the differences from the mean incomes basically represent the level of inequality in any distribution. But the idea of Gini coefficient is different, and it says that instead of looking at differences from the mean income, we should take into consideration the differences between all possible pair of incomes and simply sum the absolute differences. So instead of taking the difference from the mean income, what you do is you take the pairwise difference. So every individual, say you have 10 individuals in a society, then say you have 1, 2, 3 till 10 individuals, then the idea of Gini coefficient is that you take the difference of the first individual's income from the second individual's income. Then you take the difference of the first individual's income from the third individual's income, from the fourth individual's income, from 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th, 9th till 10th. And similarly, you repeat the same for every individual here. So you basically take the differences for each possible combinations in the distribution. And then you take the absolute value, the mod value of these differences, and you sum these. So the term for Gini coefficient will look like this, where you now have two summation signs because you are summing it on two differences. So you have what you really do here is that you have income classes J, and now you have K as well, which also represents the same income classes from 1 to M. You take the difference between YJ and YK, and then you multiply this with NJ and K, which represents the number of people in the two income classes. So what you really do when you have two summations is that you keep one of these values fixed. So say you keep J fixed at value 1. And you take the pairwise difference of J first income class with all possible income classes from 1 to M. So as I gave, as I just demonstrated in this example, where you have 10 individuals. So say you had to take the difference, all pairwise differences. Then what you'll do is that you will keep one fixed. So you keep the first income class fixed, and then you take the difference of the first income class with the first income class, then with the second income class, and with the third, fourth, till 10th. So this is what's happening. You keep J constant and you vary the K value. Similarly, you keep K constant and you vary the J value. So this, and then to normalize this, you first divide it by N square, because N square will be the total number of combinations that you can form in a population where you have N people. Total population is N. So the N square will be the total number of pairs that could be formed. And you have mean income here. And you also have number 2 here. Why do you have number 2 here? Because you are basically counting the deviations twice. That's why you also half the Gini coefficient, because you are making an error of double counting here. How? Say J value is 1 and K value is 2. Similarly, you are one possible case is that J is 2 and K is 1. But effectively, you will, when you take this sum, you will consider both these cases. But effectively, both of them are same. You are basically taking the difference of income between the first and the second class. Similarly, you are taking the difference of income between second and first class. It's more or less the same thing. So because we are taking a double summation sign here, we will count the same pairs twice. And to normalize that, we divide the entire value by 2. So this is what the Gini coefficient looks like. And Gini coefficient also satisfies all four principles. It satisfies the Dalton principle and it is Lorentz consistent. Let's look at why it would satisfy the Dalton principle. Say you have arranged your income levels in say an ascending order like this. And this is the mean income, YM. And YJ is this level and YK is this level, and you are saying that you are making a transfer from YJ to YK. Let's say you are making a small transfer delta from YJ to YK. So when you transfer delta amount of income from YJ, YJ will reach a point to the left where the level will now be YJ minus delta. So this will be YJ minus delta, and YK will reach a point to the right and it will become YK plus delta. And we say that for the Dalton principle to hold true, the value of Gini coefficient should increase if it satisfies the Dalton principle. Now, let's look at what's happening now. We are basically looking at pairwise differences in the case of Gini coefficient. Now, for every income that is to the left of yj, for any income level that is to the left of yj, the difference between yj and all of these income levels have decreased. Consider all the incomes to the left of yj. And if you look at all these income levels to the left of yj, you will see that the distance between yj and all of these income levels has narrowed, has decreased, because yj has moved to the left, right? And this decrease has been compensated for the increase in the distance of all of these income levels with yk, because yk has moved to the right. So yj ke left side mein jitne bhi income points hain, unka distance, unka deviation from yj has decreased, because yj has shifted leftwards. So obviously the distance will also narrow. If suppose you take this point, and in the initial case the distance between y2 and yj was this. Now, because yj has reached at this point, the distance between y2 and yj is this much. So jitne bhi points left side mein hai yj ke, the distance between them have decreased, but the same has been compensated with the increase in the distance from all of these income points from yk. So y2 was this far from yk in the initial case. This is yk, but now it has moved further away from yk, because yk has moved to the right by delta. So yj se jitne bhi points left mein hain, wo yj se close aa gaye hain, lekin yk se door chale gaye hain by the same proportion, by the same amount. With a pairwise deviation loge, then this effect will get cancelled out, because jitna wo narrow aaye hain yj ke, utna hi wo far ho gaye hain yk ke by the same amount delta. So these two effects will get cancelled out when you take the sum of the pairwise deviations. Similarly, when you look at the income points to the right of yk, when you look at the income points to the right of yk, the same is happening. They are coming closer to yk, but they are moving away from yj by the same amount delta. So income levels to the left of yj, or income levels to the right of yk, you will notice that the differences between the deviations have been cancelled out, because in the entire distribution it is only the position of yj and yk that is getting changed. Baki kisi ka position change nahi ho raha hai. So we are only we are only looking at the pairs of the income levels with respect to yj and yk. So we say that left side mein jitne bhi income points hain yj ke, they have come closer to yj, but they have moved away from yk by the same amount. Similarly, yk ke right mein jitne bhi points hain, they have come closer to yk, but they have moved away from yj by the same amount. So the two effects will get cancelled out, and there will be no change in g with respect to these pairs. Now we are only left with the distribution between yj and yk. Left side of yj dekh liya, right side of yk we have seen, and we see that the two will cancel each other out. But we are left with the distribution between yj and yk, and if you look at points which lie between yj and yk, you will notice that the distance of these points from yj and yk have increased. In fact, the distance between yj and yk also has increased. So if you focus on the distribution between yj and yk, you will notice all pairwise distances with respect to yj and yk have increased. And so the value of g will also increase when there is a regressive transfer made from a smaller level of income to a higher level of income. So we can say by looking at this analysis, we can say that this coefficient, this measure of inequality, is Dalton sensitive. It satisfies the Dalton principle, and hence is also. So these are basically the five measures of inequality, where we saw that how the first three could not be used because of different reasons, primarily the same reason, but the first two are actually entirely, they are sort of redundant measures because they don't take into consideration the entire distribution. They hide a lot of information. The third one, although takes into consideration the entire distribution, but doesn't satisfy the properties of inequality. And the last two measures, which is coefficient of variation and Gini coefficient, are the measures that are actually the ones, the promising measures of inequality that we use when we analyze distributions in terms of its inequality. And you will also notice that in a lot of cases, especially in cases when Lorentz curve cross each other, when there are distributions, and if you plot the Lorentz curve for these two distributions, and if they are crossing, then you will notice that the Gini coefficient and the coefficient of variation might give you opposite results. Meaning that one might show that the inequality is increasing and the other might show that the inequality is decreasing. So that is why you have two measures of inequality to sort of also dwell deeper into the idea of inequality and see what is really happening, because it's possible that you might get opposite results when you look at these measures separately for the same kind of change. For the same kind of change in inequality, you might get different results.